The event, a stand-up for nuclear Philippines, is set to take place at the end of the month with the aim of promoting and educating Filipinos on the advantages of nuclear energy as an alternative power source. Now is the country ready to include nuclear energy, nuclear power in its energy mix? And joining us now to discuss this.
I'm Denise, glad to be here.
Good afternoon, sir. I guess, first off, we'd like to start. What are the key reasons behind your support for nuclear energy in the Philippines, considering the concerns about safety and security?
Yes, I have been on top of nuclear for 17 years now. And the more I look into it, the more non-issues are the safety and the fears about nuclear waste are unfounded. There are solutions to all of this. The reason why nuclear is so important for the Philippines is that the energy density of nuclear fuel, makes it that we need a coal plant of 1,000 megawatts. It would consume, we would need to import between 700 million to 1 billion US dollars every year in terms of coal, imported coal, or if it's LNG, imported LNG. But if it were nuclear, it's only $20 million a year. So that alone would mean, just before this segment, you talked about the peso-dollar exchange rate, no? Mm-hmm. So if we were to save billions of dollars a year in avoided coal or gas or LNG importation, then that would positively affect our peso-dollar rate. The stronger the peso, the cheaper all the products are. So we have been avoided as an investment destination for the last, 30-plus years because our electricity was either too expensive or in short supply, unreliable. And if we tried everything else, since 1986 until today, all the administrations have failed in their energy policy as far as electricity is concerned. And so that's why we need nuclear.
Congressman, it's great that you mentioned that we're able to save more. The Philippines can also progress. And I wanted to know more details on your perspective on the cost effectiveness of nuclear energy, given the potential high initial investments on it.
Yes, well, if you look at the EIA numbers, the operating and maintenance cost of nuclear, and that includes fuel, that includes the end-of-life decommissioning trust fund, that includes the final waste disposition trust fund, that includes regulation, it's 1 peso and 30 centavos per kilowatt hour. Now, if you apply, for example, if you have a 1,000 megawatt nuclear plant that would generate 8 billion kilowatt hours a year. If you apply 2 pesos for capital recovery and profit, that would be 16 billion pesos a year. Multiply that by 20 years or 40 years or whatever your repayment period would be, and that will be only 3 pesos and 30 centavos per kilowatt hour. So it is inherently cheap, it is inherently clean, yet it is reliable. It's a big difference with nuclear compared to any other energy source.
Now let's address some issues of critics because they argue that the Philippines lacks the infrastructure to safely manage radioactive waste from nuclear energy. So Congressman, I guess, how do you propose to address this challenge?
It is already addressed in the bill that has already been approved in committee several times. In fact, joint committee between the Committee on Energy and the Committee on Nuclear Power has finalized the bill. Unfortunately, we are out of time mm-hmm. to pass it on second and third reading before the break. We break this afternoon. But I'm very confident that once we return, we can pass this bill in the House. And I think we have strong support, enough numbers to pass the bill in the
Senate. You propose to address the challenge of critics arguing that there isn't enough infrastructure to safely manage?
So the bill creates the PhilATOM, which is the independent regulator, and the bill goes way far to ensure its fiscal independence. In fact, that's what held the bill up. No, for the next 10 years, there will be a revenue source for the regulator. It does not have to depend on politics or the budget to be funded. And then when nuclear plants start running, they will be charged a regulation fee so that this regulator will be surely funded. Now, we don't want to reinvent the wheel. So the regulator is authorized to use the regulatory regime from the vendor NRC, if it comes from France, from the French regulator, Canada, the Canadian regulator. So we are not reinventing the wheel. As far as nuclear operators are concerned, this is more like the airline industry, where you train pilots. The pilots are certified, and they get their certification. You don't even have to be an engineer to be a nuclear operator. I don't think we want scientists to be running our nuclear plants, for the simple reason that we don't want experiments done on our nuclear power plants. So I think the parallel is the airline industry. If you look at our airline industry, we are as safe as any international airline. And so I'm very confident, you know, you have simulators. In the past, we didn't have training simulators for nuclear power plants. So it's much easier to train competent and proficient operators. You can simulate any emergency in simulator. You couldn't do that before.
Now, speaking of training, I guess this time around, how does the government plan to engage with and also address the concerns of communities near potential nuclear power plant sites?
In fact, if you look at nuclear plants all over the world, the locals love their nuclear power plant because it makes their local economy progress. It provides an anchor of high-paying jobs. Every 1,000 megawatts nuclear plant would have around 1,000 highly paid workers. One key to getting social buy-in is to have free electricity for the hosting community. And in fact, that's what I've done in Labrador Town, which is in my district. I've been spending lots of hours in every barangay explaining to the people all about the controversies about nuclear power and why it is beneficial. And they have already issued letters, notarized documents saying that they know it's controversial. Some people say it's dangerous, but they believe it's safe, and they believe it would be beneficial to their town. And they are inviting the national government or nuclear entities to locate in their town in exchange for what I said, free electricity for the entire life of the nuclear plant, based on an index year, say 2021. In Labrador, for example, two times their index consumption for every 1,000 megawatts for the entire 80-year life of the nuclear power plant. So they feel that if they have the cheapest electricity in the Philippines, it will attract so many investors to their town, and they will be able to create thousands of jobs, which would really uplift their lives.
It's great that we're seeing all the benefits, but how about considering the Philippines' susceptibility to natural disasters, how do you also propose to ensure the safety and resilience of these power plants?
Well, because of the way nuclear plants are built, the seismic design basis for nuclear buildings, their resistance to their resistance to earthquake. If there was an emergency, a typhoon or an earthquake, the local community would want to run to the nuclear plant to seek shelter. It would be the safest place in the locality.
And the Bataan Nuclear Power Plant, we all know, was built during the time of President Ferdinand Marcos Jr.'s father. Are you also expecting him to support this push?
It's up to him. He has political considerations to consider. He has local politics to consider. I find it wasteful that we have an over 100 billion peso nuclear power plant that has not run, that is 100% complete, that in 1984 passed its hot functional testing. In other words, all equipment were run with steam created in the steam generators from electricity. And in 1985, the IAEA sent its OSAR-2 mission here, and the plant was certified as ready for core loading. The fuel was in place, but politics prevented it from running. And until we reached February 1986, and the rest is history. So because we did not run Bataan, because nuclear is the safest energy source ever devised by humankind, the most deadly is coal. Bataan became a coal power plant province, has 3,500 megawatts of coal. The implication is that thousands of Bataeños and Filipinos had shortened lifespans because we went 55% coal instead of nuclear. Nuclear has already saved over 2 million lives in the world because it, of all the pollution that it has avoided compared to coal. So that's the other side of the coin that people have not looked at. And I think the evidence, and I can present it all to you, shows that that is the implication.
Lastly, Congressman, I guess, how do you respond to the argument that investing in renewable energy sources might be a safer and a more sustainable path for the Philippines, considering the global push for cleaner energy?
Well, nuclear is considered worldwide as clean energy. And the numbers are that the world fleet would increase by 300% before 2050. And I think the president is underinformed by his Department of Energy. I think they are not explaining to him the consequences of intermittent and fluctuating power caused by too much penetration of wind and solar. And I feel that renewable energy, wind and solar in particular, is riding on the good name of hydroelectric, which is also renewable. When they talk about wind and solar, which on quiet evenings is zero output, and on quiet overcast days is very low output, such that we have to invest in gas LNG power plants. And that's why the DOE is giving all kinds of licenses to build LNG receiving terminals. And so we are going to be trapped into these long-term investments of imported fossil fuels. And that is what is making our electricity so expensive. So can you imagine on a sunny day, a sunny windy day, when solar and wind are producing at full capacity, we are going to idle this gas plant that we are investing in. And who pays for the idling of these gas plants? You cannot shut them down completely. They still consume a little gas. They still you still pay the salaries. They will foist this cost on the people as they have always done so. And I think they only have to look at Germany, which has failed miserably in their energy wende. Now the price of electricity in Germany is more than double the price of electricity in nuclear France. I would like to the president to look more at emulating nuclear France than failed Germany as far as energy is concerned. In fact, Germany is now deindustrializing. A big company like BASF has announced they are leaving Germany. They are going to locate in the United States and China because they cannot anymore tolerate the high industrial electricity prices in Germany. Why should we do that? We're not a rich country like Germany.